and it was thought-provoking. I would like to point out to the rest of the speakers that we must finish this seminar before the prayer time, that is Namaz Maghrib. No, we have got plenty of time. And after Dr. Howard, a very familiar face and very well-known scholar, research scholar, author, educationist, and a real believer, I must say, the biggest qualification anyone can possess, Dr. Hussain Mohammad Jafri. I'll request him to deliver his lecture. Dr. Jafri.
Well, it is indeed a great pleasure to be here with you this evening and to say a few words. Mr. Hadi, Askari rang me, asking me that you have to come and say something. I was not actually willing, or feeling well, in fact. This seminar was meant mainly for our guest scholars, and I am here to talk to you any time, but I thought that most of the time should be given to our guest scholars. Anyway, I will take only a few minutes. Just now, Dr. Howard said a few very kind words for me. I thank him very much. It took me back to about 28 years when I was, as he said, a young professor at the American University of Beirut. But at that time, about 10 years I stayed there, I must say that he was one of the best as a professor I have come across in 10 years' time, and really he proved to be a great scholar. He served the scholarship purpose, and as you heard before, he contributed so much to real, deep, serious scholarship. And just now, the lecture he has given, the paper he has presented here, it is indeed a great insight into the history of a very difficult period of Islam. When Mr. Hadi Askari asked me to come and say a few words, I was thinking what to say. My guest speakers have been given topics. I had to choose a topic for myself. Don't be afraid, I will not take much of your time. So I thought that in these few minutes, what best I can do is to introduce a great living miracle of Hazrat Ali ibn Abi Talib. And that living miracle is Nahj-al-Balagha, the collection of his sermons, letters, and sayings. After the Quran and the traditions of the Prophet, the greatest treasure which has come down to us from the early Islam is the book known as Nahj-al-Balagha, which I don't know why has not been paid that attention which it deserves in Islamic heritage and in Islamic learning. Well, how to look at Nahj-al-Balagha and its importance. We talk about religion, and Hazrat Ali's personality certainly is a great religious personality. What does mean religion? How we explain religion, how we understand religion? Well, let me put it this way, that there is the religion and there is a religion. The religion means to establish a relationship between absolute truth and relative truth. To establish a relationship between absolute reality and a relative reality. This is, we call the religion. And this is the religion which is common to all the religions of the world, and that is the meaning of unity of religion. This endeavor to establish relationship between absolute truth and absolute reality and relative truth and relative reality is common to all religions. And I put my emphasis on this. Then this the religion, how it becomes a religion? That particular methodology with which you try to establish that relationship between absolute truth and relative truth makes the religion a religion. And this methodology that is distinguishes one denomination from the other. Now in this a religion, there are two fundamental things with which a religion is distinguished and identified, and that is the person or personality of the person who is presenting that religion, a religion, and the book and the message which he conveyed to the people. These two things make the religion a religion. This is common to Christianity, Judaism, Islam, and outside Abrahamic family of religion, Buddhism, Taoism, Confucianism, and so on and so forth. We divide religion in two families, Abrahamic family and non-Abrahamic family. Everywhere you will find a religion means a particular methodology with which that religion is identified. Now, religion in its beginning is always a revolution, a message, a faith in action, a faith in action. Then, either in the lifetime of the founder of that religion or soon after him, there is interpretation of that religion. And in fact, all religions depend how they are interpreted, and the fundamentals of religion given by the founder of religion are interpreted for the future. And here comes the personality of Ali ibn Abi Talib. There's famous saying, a tree is known by its fruit. Islam, how to understand, how to interpret, and who should interpret it? You have just heard from our first scholar a very scholarly presentation about the personality of Ali ibn Abi Talib, his birth, his death, his circumstances of his birth, his personal qualities, and so on and so forth. The nearest person to the Prophet from his birth till the death of the Prophet, who accepted Islam when the Prophet first pronounced it at the age of 10, at the most 13, and so on and so forth. I will not repeat all that. So he was the witness from the childhood till the death of the Prophet of all the doing and sayings of the Prophet. And therefore, who else could interpret Islam better than Ali ibn Abi Talib? Well, Nahj-al-Balagha, which I just mentioned to you, is the collection of his sermons and sayings and letters, particularly of those 4.5 years of his caliphate, mainly. We can divide it into, actually the book itself is divided into three themes, major themes. One, doctrine, or I should say this way, that each and every religion depends on these three things: doctrine, ethics arising or coming out from that doctrine, and the history of that religion. These three religions, three aspects, are the fundamental and main aspects of every religion: doctrine, ethics, and history. Nahj-al-Balagha comprises of these three main aspects. Doctrine, now the fundamental doctrines of Islam are Tawheed, Prophecy, Maad or Eschatology, and few others. Now, you will find in Nahj-al-Balagha that Ali ibn Abi Talib interpreting Tawheed, the concept of oneness of God, the concept of prophethood, the concept of Maad, the concept of Qiyamah, and all these things which provide doctrine for a religion. Unless doctrine is correct, neither ethics can come, nor anything from that religion can come. So if doctrine is correctly interpreted, then that religion can be presented in its truest form. So the interpretation of doctrine, you will not find anywhere the oneness of God, the concept of the oneness of God interpreted so well, so authentically and authoritatively as it is done in Nahj-al-Balagha. Quran is there. This is the word of God. Who interpret the Quran? Quran talks about oneness of God. Who will explain what does mean the oneness of God? Keep on reading Nahj-al-Balagha. You will understand what does mean the oneness of God. Then the second aspect is ethics. And actually, it is the ethical and moral aspect of religion which is perhaps very important in dealing and in the manifestation of that religion. And here you will find that Nahj-al-Balagha talks about the ethics of Islam. What does it mean? What is morality? The principles of ethics and the principles of morality. And then the third part of Nahj-al-Balagha, or the theme of Nahj-al-Balagha, is history. We understand that there's a general principle in history that the most contemporary source is the most authentic source. The nearest to the event is the most authentic source, and this is because whenever we study something, we go back to the earliest possible source. You have just heard about Jamal and Safin and the events which took place. Now, these 30 years, the prophetic period is the period of revolution. The 25 years or 30 years period of the Rashidun Caliphate is the formative period of Islam. Prophets 23 years are the foundational year. I repeat myself. And the 30 years of the first four caliph is the formative years of Islam. Whatever happened in these 30 years that put the seal on the history of Islam. And the rest was just continuation of that. Now, from where to get the correct, authentic information of these 30 years? The earliest possible history goes back to the end of first century, which could not survive. It survived in larger histories, which later came out, like Yaqubi, Dinabari, and so many others. I don't bother you with these names. So, the earliest history perhaps was written after 100 years. Ibn Ishaq, who wrote the Seerah of the Prophet, biography of the Prophet, was born in 80 Hijra and died in 150 Hijra. You can judge from this. And after that comes the historians. Ali is the personality who is the witness of all the events and the partner of all the events. And he is talking about the events. So it is the most contemporary history, most contemporary history of Islam, of those formative years which put the seal on the fate of Islam and the future of Islam. Now, Nahj-al-Balagha has been, I don't know why, for what reasons, has been neglected, whereas history has been studied, all the historical works and other works have been studied, but Nahj-al-Balagha had been neglected. In this century, fortunately then, people turned to Nahj-al-Balagha, and most comprehensive commentary of Nahj-al-Balagha was written in the medieval period by one Ibn Abil Hadid. Ibn Abil Hadith was not a Shi. He wrote Nahj-al-Balagha, the new edition published from Egypt, edited by Muhammad Abul Fazl Ibrahim, is in 20 volumes. Well, in 1840, Sheikh Muhammad Abdu of Egypt, of Al-Azhar, perhaps in modern times, was the first person, the reformer of Egypt, and the Sheikh of Al-Azhar, Sheikh Muhammad Abdu, a great name in the modern history of Islam. He was the person who edited, wrote notes on it, and published Nahj-al-Balagha in 1840. And from then on, I see that edition after editions were published of Nahj-al-Balagha, and there are a number of new editions which are coming out from Beirut, from Egypt, from Iraq. Most of the editors are not Shia, but they have now recognized the merits and the greatness of this work. If you want to understand Islam, Islamic doctrine, go to the person who is the most authoritative to interpret the doctrine. If you want to understand the ethics of Islam, go to the person who opened his eyes in the lap of the Prophet and died in the house of God. And if you want to know the history of Islam, go to the person who has been the witness, eyewitness for all what happened in Muslim history. This is Nahj-al-Balagha. Well, I'm glad to say that some parts of Nahj-al-Balagha are coming very soon. It is in the press. I have published Amir al-Mumneen's letter to Malik ibn Ashtar, and two more letters in one volume with a long commentary of about 100 pages. It is in the press, which will come very soon. And then if God helps me and give me this opportunity, well, I have been working on this project for some time. Perhaps I may publish it in English translation, the whole thing. So I thought that I can satisfy Mr. Hadi Askari's request or his desire just by saying few words and introducing Ali's living miracle, which is Nahj-al-Balagha. That is a miracle. That is a miracle for all times to come. Well, certainly I am concluding my remarks. Certainly the personal qualities of Amir al-Mumneen are great. You have just heard. We are listening to it very often. But I am more interested in a religious leader who made from the religion a religion, his methodology of making the religion a religion, that methodology, that message can survive throughout the human history. Ali was born at the middle or beginning of the second half of the first millennium. We are entering into the third millennium. Ali was alive and fresh at that time as he is today and will remain in the third millennium. The question is, well, I feel very, very, what I should say, sad when I see that religious people, actually this has become perhaps something of very peculiar of religion, that religious people try to convert others to their religion. A Shia would like others to make Shia, and a Sunni would like others to make Sunni. A Muslim would like people to become Muslim. A Christian would like missionaries working, you know, all over the world to make Christian. I sometimes ask, for God's sake, Shia is making Shia, and Sunni is making Sunni, and Muslim is making Muslim, and Christian is making Muslim. Is there anyone who makes human being? Ali is one who wanted to make human beings. And that is the greatness of Ali, and that aspect of religion will remain as long as this earth is there and the skies are there. Thank you very much.